So some of you who are looking at trying to see how whether we are writing a poker bot or something, it might come as a little bit of disappointment to some of you. So the idea of this talk is actually how do you run random simulations and how Python really helps you do those things effectively. Okay, so that's the basic idea of this talk. So let's get started. Okay, a little bit about me. So I work as independent consultant. Mostly do my consultancy in Python, but I do in other languages also. So I run a consultancy company called Hypnoe Software Labs. And Python is my go-to language for trying out new ideas. And this talk is about one of such ideas that I wanted to try about, to try. Okay. So before we go through the talk, so let me try to explain what was the motivation for this particular talk. So some time back I was thinking, what if we could simulate a large number of poker games? Can that help us define or develop some strategies that you want to that you could use to play a poker game? Okay, so how many of you know about poker, first of all, right? Okay, so it's an interesting multiplayer card game. I'll be giving a quick introduction of that. So this started with a question, basically, can we come out with some strategies if we can simulate a large number of games? And then I started kind of working backwards. Okay, so how do you simulate one single game? And if you have to simulate one single game, how do you basically, what are the challenges involved? And this talk is basically going to be talking about all of that, okay? So we'll be talking about why this particular problem. So just be with me. Then I'll give a quick introduction about game of poker and what are poker hands, etc. How are we going to rank them? By the way, there's going to be a lot of Python code here. Not a lot about different packages, but just Python built-ins and Python standard library. Okay, then we will see how we can simulate one single poker game. And then we are going to look at some results of, I ran some of those simulations myself, and then we are going to look at some of the results of simulations of those games. Okay, so let's see, I mean, why this particular problem? Okay, so one of the reasons I chose this problem is because, as I said, like I really like Python for trying out answers to some questions that I have. And this is one of such questions. Also, it turns out this is a very good candidate for one to actually be able to think in Python. What do I mean by thinking in a particular language? Okay, so what do I mean by thinking in a particular language is every language has got certain built-ins, certain constructs, okay, that are available with every language. So C has got like a very, very basic, which is like very core to or very close to machine kind of language. Python is like a reasonably high level, but lets you do a lot of things. So basically thinking in a language means you need to be able to think in terms of the construct standard library and built-ins of the language. So, and I thought this is a pretty good interesting candidate problem for being able to think like that. As we'll see soon, Python has got some built-ins like lists, dictionary sets, and ranking poker hands is a very interesting challenging problem, and in the absence of something like a set abstraction, it becomes a very hard problem to solve. So I think one key takeaway from this talk, if any, should be like there's a lot of power in Python's built-in and standard library alone, and we should be able to appreciate that. Okay. So I'll give a quick introduction about a game of poker, so that people who don't know about the game of poker will have some idea. So it's basically a multiplayer card game, and as any multiplayer card game will involve some kind of randomness, some kind of luck. Okay, so the way this game is played is each player is dealt two cards initially, and then there are total of 5 cards which are called as community cards, which are basically dealt as 3 first, then 1 more, and then 1 more. So basically what I say is these are the different stages of a game. Okay, and at each of these rounds there is basically betting that happens. Okay, and the betting happens in a round robin manner. And whenever a player has bet, you can actually match that player's bet, or you can bet higher than what the player has bet, which is in poker terminology called as raise, or you decide your hand is not good enough to continue and you simply fold it. Okay, so this is a very common poker terminology. And at each stage, all the bets of all the players should be equal. If the bets are not equal, the player with the highest bet or the best hand wins. Okay, so that's quickly about what is there in the game of poker. Okay, so how many of you know Project Euler? So this is one of the interesting problems on Project Euler. If you see, how do you compare poker hands? Okay, and we are going to look at Python code to do that. So before we let's look at what are typical poker hands. Okay, so in a card game, right? So the way poker hands are defined, or the way a hand is ranked higher, is based on how low the probability of that particular hand is. Okay, so at the top you have something called as a royal flush, which is basically sequence of cards of the same suite. Okay, after that it's basically the sequence of card of the same suite, but as you see, ace to 10 is higher than 8 to 4. And then you have different kind of cards, different kind of hands, depending upon what are the odds against those kind of hands. Okay, so I'll show. So this is from Wikipedia. I don't know how visible it is, but this should give you some overview about how a rank, how a particular hand is ranked higher. Okay, so one which has got the lowest probability or the lowest number of possible hands, this is simple maths. Okay. Or the one which has got the highest number of odds against a particular hand is ranked higher. Okay, so as you see that basically this is how hands are ranked in a game of poker. So the first one that you see has got a very high, almost more than half a million odds against it, whereas if you see the last one, which is basically 1-1, so pretty much about 50% of the hands are like the last kind of hands. Okay, we will look at how actually we are going to be able to rank the hands like this. Okay, okay, so enough about poker. So let's speak some Python now. So to be able to simulate games, let's see how are we going to basically represent a card, then we are going to represent a deck, and then we are going to represent poker hands. Okay, so each card has got basically a rank and a suite. Okay, so rank is basically 1 to 13, so 1 is for ace, but we will use actually different ranks, which is called 2 to 14. The reason being, ace is actually ranked higher than king and queen. Okay, so these are the reasons we are using a different numerical numbers. Okay, and then there are four suites in a card deck, which is paired, heart, diamond and club. So simply we can represent a card by the rank and the suite. Okay, and for every rank we will have some notion of value, which will indicate the score of that particular hand, and this will come handy when we are going to be comparing the hands. Okay, so again some simple Python that shows how a poker deck of card is going to look like. So we have a list of hands, and then a dictionary where keys are the ranks and the values are their particular score, and then you can simply do quickly, you can have a deck of the card is going to look something like this. Simple Python, all built-ins. We have not used anything more than Python built-ins. And then let's look at different kind of poker hand. So basically a poker hand then is simply just a list of 5 cards, and that can be represented as follows. So the first hand is a flush, which is basically all cards are of the same suite, which is ace, jack, 9, 6 and 2 of spade. The second card is a full house, where you have 2 aces and 3 kings. And third card is basically a high card, which is not a particular type of hand, which is like 50% of the card hands, 5 card hands are like this. Okay, so you have, these are different kinds of poker hands. Okay, so now we'll look at how are we going to compare these hands. Okay, so one way of going about it is we are going to define a class called as poker hand. Okay, and basically we will be writing comparator operator for that particular class. Okay, magic functions in Python, if you guys know. Okay, strictly speaking, there's really no reason that you should be using class or something, but when we simulate a game, we will see why this becomes very handy. So we are basically going to be using the class. Okay, so this is what we are going to be doing. Okay, so the hand is going to look something like this. It's a class, and then it has got these different attributes, which are the cards, suites, ranks, and then there is, in the end, you have something called as an ordered. So we'll come to it when we are basically comparing two hands, right? The two hands could actually have same score, and then when they have a same score, how are you going to do a tiebreaker? So this is where this order is going to come into play. So we'll look at little detail about implementation of some of this. Okay. So this is going to be our broad strategy. Okay. First, given a poker hand, see if you can identify the type of a hand. Okay, if you can identify the type of a hand, see if you can actually assign some score or value to the hand. So that's roughly going to be our strategy. Okay, so if you want to find out whether a hand is a flush, that means all the cards have the same suite, and this is something you can do in Python using length of set of suites equal to 1. So okay, if this condition is true, that means it's a flush. Okay, similarly, if there are only two ranks, if the set of ranks is only 2, then it's going to be either a 4 of a kind and a 1, and or a 3 of a kind and 2 of a kind. So this is basically, this gives us some idea about how we can go about finding the type of a hand. Okay, a straight is a sequence. So basically, max of the ranks and minimum of the ranks, the difference is going to be 4. There's one more condition actually here, that all of them have to be distinct cards, which I have not mentioned here, but this gives us some idea about how we can broadly try to solve the problem of identifying the type of a hand. Okay, so having said that, let's look at some actual code that does that. We discussed something like this. Some of this code might look a little complicated, but it's not really one. So if you look at the straight, it's basically all the ranks are unique, which basically says that length of set of ranks is 5 and max minus min is 4. But also we need to take care of one more, some of the corner cases need to be taken care of. For example, ace 2, 3, 4, 5 is also a straight. So we need to take care of that. And so the second condition is taking care of that. So basically you can simply say this is how a straight is look like. And then a straight flush is basically, it's a flush and a straight. So this is how we can actually determine the different kinds of what are going to be the different kinds of hand, type of a particular hand. Okay, and like there are about 7 types of hand, and this is what we are going to be determine. Okay, so now once we have identified the type of a hand, the next step is going to be how are we going to assign a score to that particular hand. Okay, so we start with a basic score of 1, which is what every card gets, and if a card is of a particular type, we kind of double the score. And if you look at if you remember the original probability, okay, at the lowest level there is a pair, which is basically the score is twice the score of the original hand, and we simply keep on multiplying the score by 2. Left shift by 2 is basically multiplying by 2. And if you see, if you have a straight and a flush, you will have a score which is multiplied by 2 raised to 5 times 2 raised to 4, which is basically 2 raised to 9. Okay, so that's basically how you can see that a particular hand, you will have a score of a particular hand. Okay, so we have done 2 steps here. First, identified the type of the hand, then we actually assign some kind of a score to a hand. Okay, so if we now compare the scores of 2 hands, we are pretty much there to solving this particular problem. Okay, there's one more thing though. It's quite likely that 2 hands do have the same score, and in that case, how are we going to be doing a tiebreaker? Okay. So this ordered is actually doing that. Okay, it's actually doing that. So if you look at it, it's basically a list of tuples. Okay, I think my next slide is going to explain what the ordered is look like. So the code might look a little difficult, a little ugly, but it's actually a list of tuples basically. Okay, which is of the form, the first is the rank, and the second element of the tuple is basically the count of the rank. Okay, so the way you are going to be comparing this is, first you will be comparing the count. If the count is higher, then the hand is higher. If the counts are equal, then you are basically going to be comparing the rank. Okay, and now if we look at this, this is basically what the sorted is doing. It's first looking at the key 1, which is the second key of the tuple. If that is, if those are equal, then it is going to look at key 0 of the tuple. Okay, so this is going to be serving as a tiebreaker when we are this is going to be serving as a tiebreaker when we are basically going to be comparing the hands. Okay, so one trivia is this hand is from the movie Casino Royale. So if you've seen this movie, you will probably remember this hand is from that movie. Okay, and once we have done something like this, the next step is basically we are going to be defining what is called as a comparator operator. Okay, so we are defining only a less than comparator operator. We are not defining others, because if a hand is not less than other, we don't basically care, because there are occasionally scenarios in poker games where the two hands are equal, indeed equal. That happens sometimes, though rarely. And in that case, in the poker terminology, that is called as basically a split pot. So both the players who are in the game till the end are actually going to be the winner in this particular case. Okay. So basically, what we have looked at is, okay, so we had like three steps in solving this problem. The first step was basically comparing the hands. So we are kind of basically solved that, okay? So the next step is going to be trying to see how we are going to be able to simulate one particular poker game. And once we are able to simulate one particular poker game, the next one we will see is how we can simulate a large number of such games. And once we have that, we will look at some of the results from a large number of such games and try to find out, are there some interesting strategies? I mean, we originally started with that question, and we are actually arriving at that answer. Okay, so basically this is how we are trying to arrive at that answer. Okay. Okay, so basically what does a poker game consist of? It's basically a table that contains a given number of players. Then there are different actions, like you have the first deal where each player is dealt two cards, and then there are different actions when the first three community cards are revealed. It is called as flop, and then there is a turn and river. So basically when we want to simulate a poker game, we need to be able to simulate some of these actions, okay? And that is what we will be doing when simulating a poker game. Okay, so basically what do we need to simulate a poker game? We need a shuffle deck, then we need a number of players. Okay, and we need each player's initial hand, because each player will be initially dealt two cards, and we need to know about what that player's initial hand is going to look like, which we call it as a mini poker hand. So if you look at it, this mini poker hand also derives from the same class called as base poker hand. The reason being, there is an overlap in most of the functionality between a poker hand of five cards versus a poker hand of just two cards. And we just wanted to abstract out that functionality, and this is where it actually helps in using that object oriented feature. Otherwise, strictly speaking, there is no need to simply force object oriented behavior on that. Okay, so we now know what is it required to actually simulate a card. So we will actually start with a class called as poker table. So it's kind of a bad name that I initially started with, and then I had to stick with it. So if you look at the code, you will come to know why, but it's okay. It could have been called as a poker game rather than calling it as a poker table, but that's what it is. Okay. And when we are going to be simulating a poker game, we are again going to look at some of the built-ins and some functions from iTools, from standard library, combinations functions from iTools standard library, how it is going to be used. So as you would have seen so far, everything just from the standard library. In fact, so far we have not used anything from standard library other than the random. Now we'll be using some other function, some method from iTools. Okay. So this is so what we discussed so far is actually enough to actually simulate a game. Okay. But we do want to simulate a large number of such games. Okay. And when we want to simulate a large number of such games, we want to keep some additional state also in the particular class. So ideally, this is a state that you would keep outside the class, depending upon what kind of questions you want to answer. But that's fine. For our example, this is good enough. Okay, and some of the questions that we want to answer is, which player had the best hand in the initial deal? So initially, when two cards are dealt, which player had indeed the best hand? Okay, and then also we want to look at which player had the best hand at the end of flop, at the end of the turn, or at the end eventually. Okay, we also like to answer some questions like how many hands had initially pairs in them. Okay, the question would come, why those? Okay, because this is something that if you are actually a player, statistics like this could actually help you strategize how you are going to be betting. Okay, and we want to see, we will look at some results from statistics at the end. But this is an additional state that we are keeping in this particular poker table class. Ideally, this can be kept separate, but this is basically how it is. And then we need some functionality to rank players at different stages. Okay, so basically this is what the code is going to look like. So this is a function in the class, in the poker table class. Okay, so basically this function will be called either pre-flop, before the initial before the three community cards are revealed, or post-flop. Initially, you want to if you see this, this is where we are basically maintaining the state, that number of ace high players, number of pair players, or the number of mini flush players. So this is the state that we are keeping in the keeping for the game. This is a simulation state that we are keeping. Okay, and here basically when we have the community cards, so the way we want to go about is we want to be able to rank the players, right? So the way we want to go about doing that is, first we will actually make the best hand for a given player, and then compare the best hands across the players. So for a given player, using the community cards, you could actually have multiple hands that are possible. Okay, so this is what you actually do in those combinations. So use the community cards plus player's hand, and you get the player's hands, I mean possible hands that a player can make, and then you make the best hand for a player. So the sorted and reverse 2 and 0 is going to be basically the player's best hand. And once we have the best hand for each player, we are actually going to be able to compare them across the player. So basically the second one is exactly doing that, and this is the sorted that uses custom function. And the second sorted here, which is comparing across players, is actually using the comparator operator we had in the poker hand, right? So this is where. And then simply we have a very simple state. Basically, for every state, the table rank 0, player ID is going to be the winner of this particular hand. Okay. And then running one particular game is basically performing these actions. Okay. And all of these actions are part of poker table class, which is basically deal is an action. Okay, then you rank players, and then you say who is the deal winner. Then the, in poker there is a concept called as a burn card, which is basically setting aside one card from the deck. If you look at it in Python terms, it's simply list dot pop. Okay, and which is actually what that code does. It's just to make poker friendly. And so these are all actions, and after every action we perform ranking of the player, and we keep the state corresponding to that particular ranking in our game state. Okay, similarly we can do it for the turn, river, and eventually what is going to be our game winner. Okay, so basically this is how you can actually simulate a game and collect all the state corresponding to particular game. Okay, now we want to actually see, what if we actually simulate large number of such games? Are there any interesting statistics that are coming to the air? So this part is actually very simple. You just need a kind of a driver for the above code, and the driver is simply going to be like, it's going to take two variables. One is the number of players, okay, and two is basically the number of games that you want to simulate. And is simply going to run in a for loop. This is it's going to simply be running in this particular for loop, right? So this is how you are actually going to be simulating a large number of such games. Okay. In the next few slides, I have collected some statistics from simulating about 5,000 games. Okay. And these are the couple of questions that I wanted to answer. Okay. Do these statistics show some interesting patterns? Are they a function of number of players? Because this is how you are going to be developing strategies when you are going to be playing. Okay, so that's the idea. Okay, so here I'm going to show statistics for simulation of two players, and all of this code is available. So something like this you can also run yourself. So, so what did I do is basically I simulated a game for two players, Okay, so the number of players is 2 and simulated 5,000 of such games. And the kind of statistics that I'm trying to find out are as follows, right? So of the 5,000 games, about 20% of the time, which is basically about 1,000 games, okay, ace high, I mean, if a player had an ace high in the initial deal, was actually eventually winner in the game. So what does that basically means is, assuming that every player plays to the end, at the end of the game, the winner, whoever was, after we did a rank players, was the player who had initially an ace high, okay? So this is about 20% of the time. I'll explain in a bit what is a conditional probability. In about 30% of the time, a mini flush or a player who had both the cards of the same suit was actually eventually a winner, okay? And only in about 10% of the 10% of the games, the player who had a pair initially was actually a winner, okay? So these, if you look at it, these look like some kind of, let me put it this way, these look like some kind of an absolute statistics, okay? But we need to also look at, what do we mean by conditional probability, right? So let's look at the first results, okay? So of the 5,000 play games, about 1,000 games, the ace high player was winner. But there were only about 3,900 games where actually in the initial deal there was an ace high, okay? So given, now think about how conditional probability helps you, right? Let's say you are a player and you know you have an ace high hand, right? That means given you have an ace high hand, your conditional probability of eventually winning a game based purely on statistics of large number of games is about 25%. Surprisingly, which is not substantially better. In fact, it is actually comparable with respect to somebody who has a pair hand. So basically, this is how conditional probability actually helps you. So the conditional probability is going to help you when you are, as a player, you want to actually be developing some strategies, okay? I'm going to quickly run through the results, but you can note that the probabilities, both absolute and conditional, don't change substantially for three players, and we have actually very similar players for very similar results for four number of players, five players, six players, and seven players. So all of these are pretty similar results, right? About 25% of the time you have a conditional probability if you had an initial ace hand or if you had an initial pair hand that you will win, and about 33% of the time if you had both the cards of the same suite that you will actually win. Okay, so these are basically what I say is absolute and conditional probability that you will see in this. Okay, a couple of observations that one can be made. Okay, a flush in the initial deal is actually a winner. We discussed this in the both absolute and conditional terms. Okay, so the number of hands that will win if you had a flush hand in absolute terms are also likely going to be higher. And also as a conditional probability, and this is okay, the pair winners appear to be just half the number of ace high winners, but if you actually see the conditional probability, they are comparable. Okay, we have seen this. Then you can actually use this. So these are the probabilities that are talking about initial deal. Then you can actually do this along with some other statistics. Okay, I had this results, but I don't have it here. So it's in about 75% of the times, a player who is a winner at the flop is also an eventual winner. And in about almost 85% of the time, a player who's a winner at the turn is also eventually a winner. This is not very unintuitive because, you know, only if you're really winning in the turn, a really, really bad luck can actually make you lose this, okay? And a lot of the drama that you see about the poker games is usually is a function of pure luck more than a statistics, okay? A couple of observations that I have about this is, my original intuition was these statistics should actually be different for different users, but it did turn out they don't substantially change across the number of players. Okay, that was kind of a surprise, and I don't have a very good intuitive answer as to why this is so. Okay, and conditional probability will actually help you devise your strategies. Okay, so how you can use it at each stage, you can actually see. So let's say you have a conditional probability of 30% of winning a particular hand, okay? That means if you are risking less than 30% of your capital, statistically you have an edge over the others, right? So that's how you can actually use this conditional probability to strategize this. And then you can actually refine this, because you had an initial conditional probability of winning 30%, and then it appears that you are also a flop winner. Of course, it doesn't mean that it appears means doesn't mean that you will be winning. Okay, so that's basically how you can refine the strategies. Okay, so here are some references. Okay, and then there is this code I have written. So I think the links will be available. That's pretty much what I have. Okay.